For all those who appreciate the work that we're doing here on Standing for Truth, please hit that subscribe button, because we are just getting started.
I just wanted to make a real quick video about cladistics and how taxonomists can move things around as they please and how they have done this to human beings. So evolutionists are always trying to make sure that everything is related and wanted to classify man as an ape. So they came up with a way to linguistically smuggle mankind into the ape family. A scientist clipped together 5 physical features that humans share in common with apes to swindle man into that family. Basically, they played a language game. Just like the United States Post Office has systems for naming states, including 2-letter abbreviations, they will change the system if it suits them. At one time, the state abbreviation for Massachusetts was MASS, and for California, it was CALIF. Now it is reduced to just CA or MA. And they can do this with anything. They can do this with taxonomy. I can do it with a raccoon and show similarities between us and them. But what is funny to me is that these 5 things that we share in common are actually vastly different when we look into detail. Let's look at them, shall we? Marx, in 2009, said, "Apes are something that have no tail, a fused tailbone vertebrae, a large brain, and a rotating shoulder." Well, let's actually look at these things in detail. Our jaw is parabolic in shape. Not a single primate is. So now, you can see, even right out of the gate, the first similarity, when scrutinized, is very different. Next, can our shoulder rotate? Sure, obviously. But here's the thing. When we investigate this, we find that the human shoulder blades are actually unique to humans, having a combination of better lateral orientation and scapular blade shape. So now 2 things out of 5 actually show we are vastly different when we investigate them rather than just overall glaze over them at a glance. But let's go on. Is our brain larger, like in other apes? Yes, but our brain is actually much larger than all other apes, with multiple different neurons found in no other primate. For example, humans have the rosehip neurons. No ape has this. Not to mention the orphan genes that are highly expressed in the brain of humans, but not in primates. So again, even the smallest bit of investigation, when taken, looking at these similarities, we can see huge differences. I could go on down the list, showing you the differences between us and them, and the list would put you to sleep. But they put blinders on and only focus on the overall basic physical feature similarities so that they could swindle to the public and kids with wordplay. First of all, apes are not a clade. Ape is an English word. It is not a taxonomic term. English words do not need to be monophyletic. French, German, Russian, and other languages do not have to accord with English in the ways of splitting up animals. Taxonomy is international. Everywhere, worldwide, we recognize human beings as part of mankind, not apes. In France, apes are called singes, and so are monkeys. In English, we differentiate these 2 terms. But in both languages, humans are different from other primates. Does that make French right and English wrong? Does that make both languages wrong? No. It means that colloquial languages have no problem describing paraphyletic groups. It is useful to have languages that can make these distinctions. So if we must accept that humans are apes, then we must equally accept that chimpanzees are monkeys. And these ignorant people at the zoo who are pointing at apes and calling them monkeys are actually right, and I don't accept that. Just like I don't accept that people point at humans and say, "Look at the ape." That is stupid. I see value in portraying the truth and precision about phylogeny, and for that purpose, I have taxonomic terms, and I will not allow it to be including humans as apes. It's simple. Humans are known as mankind, not apes. A child can tell the difference.
Certain evangelicals have already stated that even a 5-year-old can tell. The computer identifies that cheetahs and cougars are essentially the same thing, that they should be in the same genus. That's the data from the genome. A computer, not just a child can see that, but a computer can see that. A computer doesn't have to have any human biases or assumptions.
Yet, they do. All programs need a model to run. A computer only knows what you give it. If it's looking for just a sequence, it's going to show commonality, sure. But is that all that's really required to prove common ancestry or relation? Of course not. It's just one small piece of the puzzle that evolutionists want to blow out of proportion and use it as the prime example of why everything is related. Which is ironically pretty funny, because Ernest Mayr back in the 60s predicted that because evolution must be true, that all living organisms shouldn't share any genetic similarities between each other, because deep time would have separated them by far too much. Decades later, though, it was discovered that they share many genetic similarities. So his prediction was removed and forgotten, and now it's used as one of their best pieces of evidence for evolution, when in reality it was a falsification of it. This is the Twilight Zone world that we live in today, where common sense is left on the floor for the next scientific fact they tell the public. We shouldn't smuggle taxonomic principles into everyday language to make a political argument, and that is what humans are apes ultimately is. It is an argument that we aren't as great as we actually are. Cladistic terminology is controlled by taxonomists, people who often shift their ideas as much as political opinion does. I'm promoting the idea that we use taxonomy for what it is intended purpose is, not to insist that English do the job instead. We aren't apes, and it's okay to tell your children that chimpanzees and gorillas are apes, not monkeys, because that is what is true and honest. Humans are part of mankind, not the ape kind. The classification of humans as great apes is also dependent on historical contingency. Remember, we have no existent sister taxa. In the not-so-distant past, humans shared the planet with other races of humans that are now gone. We know them as Neanderthal and Denisovan. The secular camp believes these are ancient ancestors to humans, but that they were still humans. This means that from what we know about genetics going back over 100% of our species' existence, we have shared Earth with only other humans. There is no other proof of a missing link inside of our DNA. If one or more of these other humans had survived into contemporary times, our taxonomic classification scheme for humans would probably look much different. Instead of focusing on the similarities between humans and chimpanzees, or humans and gorillas, we would likely shift our attention to focusing more on the similarities between other humans that evolution believers think are primitive humans in our own family tree. But it's nonsense for taxonomists to lump humans in with great apes. The differences are far too striking. This is why they choose simplistic, vague similarities to call us apes and force us into that cladistic category. Splitting humans from great apes allows us to reconceptualize our own humanity. It would even force the secular camp to acknowledge just how different we really are. They would be forced to see the differences and not just the few similarities. Don't be fooled by political lies with motives behind it intended to push nonsense. You see, we can do anything with words. We can label anything we want. People are doing it with sexual preferences today. We can just as easily say we are more related to raccoons than anything else. Would this hold weight? Sure, we can easily find 5 similarities with them, as was the justification to call man an ape. Evolutionists are always trying to strengthen their arguments to make evolution sound true because they have no actual physical evidence to prove that it is true, nor their ability to prove deep-time phylogenetic trees they draw are real. One such way of adding validity to their arguments is by adding different branches of science. For example, combining nucleotide variations between species, adding taxonomy, and adding physical similarities as well. But it's just a ridiculous attempt, and why it's failing them so hard. Just these 3 branches alone change all the time, because inevitably, if a biologist uses comparative anatomy, puts something in one branch, it won't take long before a taxonomist moves it to another. It just shows the inadequacy of the entire program. Imagine if all of the different branches of science had their input into helping build these trees. What a disaster that would be. Let me give you an example of how much of a mess it would be if we built one of these trees using multiple different branches of science. Let's take the skunk, for example, and compare it to a human. Well, we have similar solitary lives until we find a mate, and so do skunks. So a scientist would toss them on a related branch on the phylogenetic tree. But then a geneticist would come along and notice that the skunk is not similar to us in the fact that they have 50 chromosomes and humans have 46, so we would get removed from that branch. But then an anatomist would come along and notice that skunks have body hair and so do humans, so they would add us back in on that branch. But then a taxonomist would come along and would remove the skunk again from the tree branch because we are not in the order of carnivora. Then an ethologist would come along who notices that they are active all year around and so are humans, so they would add us back into that branch. But then a zoologist who notices that they have an anal scent gland which is used for a defensive weapon, but humans don't have such a thing, so they would move us away from that branch. But along comes a statistician who notices that they are found in most states, just like people. So they would move us back into that tree branch. But then a kinesiologist would notice that our body movements are not very similar. So they again would remove the skunk from this tree branch. But then a homologist would notice that they all look the same, just like newborn babies, moving them back into the branch. But then a pathologist would notice that skunks carry spreadable infectious disease like rabies, but humans do not, so they would get removed again from the branch. But then a mammalogist would say, skunks are mammals, and so are humans, so they would put them back into the branch again. But then a linguist would notice that a skunk doesn't have anything beyond a basic communication skills, never producing language, so again, they would be removed from the tree branch. But then comes along an anthrozoologist who notices they don't go into hibernation, just like humans, so they would be back added into the branch. Do you see where this nonsense is going? The more you investigate, the more phylogeny breaks down. This is why the current college books that teach evolution, like Tree Thinking or Evolution 101, have failed miserably at this. Of the 49 Tree of Life drawings in Evolution 101, not a single tree, 0%, includes the name of a single common ancestor, let alone even explain how the first male and female had to arise at the same time. Their explanatory power comes in the form of storytelling. Our model is far superior, and the more we investigate the small things, the more profound this becomes. Just look at the vast physiological differences between us and primates. But if that's not good enough, then listen to what a forensic investigator has to say just about hair, and just how different ours is and different from any primate on Earth, even our supposed closest ancestor, the chimp.
Having taught forensic science for many years, as well as worked in a crime scene unit, I'm really interested in those properties that make us unique, especially which distinguish humans from other things that we see in God's creation. Well, we're going to be looking at forensic hair analysis and the distinct differences between human hair and properties that we see in animal fur. We're going to look at the three basic parts of an individual hair, and that is the medulla, the cortex, and the cuticle. All right, the cuticle is that outside protective coating that does make your hair waterproof, and it has other features like that because God's pretty smart. He thinks about that. All right, our cortex is where we do find our cells and our melanin color. And then in here is something we call the medulla, and it's basically what they call an airspace. But here is where we find something very important that we can look at under the microscope and distinguish between animal kinds. There are three basic medulla patterns, all right, and that is continuous. Now, in a continuous pattern, we see this solid black line running up through the center right here, all right? In a fragmented medulla pattern, all right, we can see where it's actually broken. It's almost like Morse code. It actually looks like dots and dashes running up the center of the hair shaft. And then some people actually have what we call absent, all right, where you literally just don't see a pattern in the medulla at all. Sometimes you'll see a hair sample that looks like this, where the medulla is a little more present, but you still don't see a distinct continuous or fragmented pattern running up the center of the hair shaft. Now, these are all human hairs that you see here. What we're going to find, though, when we go look at animals, it is distinctly different. All right, another reason that we use hair, and the primary reason we would use it in forensics, is because it has the potential to provide that unique identity, all right? So one important distinction I like to make is, especially in the presentations that I give here at the museum, is that we find hair in humans, right? We are made in the image of God, and we are distinctly different than the other creations that do have what I like to say is fur, all right? So we do find fur in animals, and we do find hair in humans, and we're going to see there are distinct differences between those two as we move through the presentation today. So what we would hope to get from finding a hair sample is that DNA fingerprint that we call it, being able to find viable DNA, and we would refer to that as nuclear DNA, which is found in the nucleus of a human cell. We can also determine hair color very quickly. We can even roughly get an idea of someone's, what we say, ethnicity or people group from that hair sample. So we need to talk just a little bit about the distinct differences between human hair and animal fur, all right? Because evolutionists like to say, well, because we share these traits with animals, it's part of that evidence, they'd like to call, that we've descended from a common ancestor. And that is just not the case, all right? God equipped us each with exactly what we needed to survive in our environment. So if we take a look at human hair versus animal fur, one thing we're going to see a difference in is growth. In humans, as I said, our hair is continuous and it is independent, meaning it's all over our head at different times and at different stages. Whereas in animal fur, it is stopped and it is synchronized, all right? Especially in animals, if we notice in the winter, especially when it's up in the areas where it's colder, they're going to get much thicker, right, in their fur. Then in the spring, what happens is they start to shed, right? You start to get fur, especially my cat sheds in the spring. I get cat fur all over my house because he is shedding that. And they do stop. Their hair does stop growing at very distinct stages. I mean, does a cow need to go to the hair salon? No, right? God equipped them to have their hair stop at a very specific point. Also, diameter. In humans, on average, the diameter or the thickness, we would say, of our hair is much thinner than we are going to see in animals. Also, our medulla patterns are thinner. And we're going to see this when we look at our pictures here in just a second, that animals have a much wider and more prominent, we would say, medulla. And as far as our texture in humans, on average, you know, our hair is soft and has the potential to grow very long. But in animals, it is coarse and often very short, right? Now, there are rare exceptions because we have purposely crossed certain traits, especially of dogs, to have long hair. But that is not how they would normally exist in nature. Also, temperature regulation. In humans, our hair provides us absolutely no temperature regulation whatsoever, all right? In the winter, does your arm hair keep you warm, Mr. Patterson?
Not really. No. I usually have to put on a jacket or something.
Yeah. Does our head hair keep us warm in the winter?
It does, yeah, because it's a lot thicker, but it's
but
still...
But what do we have to put on if it's snowing?
We've got to put on a cap if it's that cold, because it's still a little thin and things can penetrate
through there. So in the winter, you still have to put on that hat, right? Because it is not going to keep you warm. Your leg hair is not going to keep you warm, right? But what about animals? Absolutely, right? God designed them to thicken up in the winter, thin out in the summer when it's warmer, and their fur is specifically designed to regulate their body temperature and allow them to live outside. And color is another distinct difference. In humans, on average, we have constant hair color, all right? That's not to say we may be lighter brown in the front or darker brown in the back, and we do get gray because our, you know, our cells dye our color. We just don't produce color anymore. But on average, it's constant, right? You're never gonna see a human with naturally growing zebra stripes, right, in their hair patterns. You're never going to see a human who has, like a cow, black, you know, and brown and you know, mustard color splotches. God just didn't create us that way. Our hair is a constant color. But in animals, you can absolutely have abrupt color change, sometimes within the same fur sample. Very distinct differences. Now, the FBI even recognizes that human hair is distinctly different. They say in human hairs, the scales form an imbricate pattern. This characteristic serves to distinguish human hairs from animal hairs. Many animal hairs have a very regular repeating pattern to their scales. So even the FBI on their website had to acknowledge that human hair is distinctly different from animal fur. And that's exactly what we'd expect to see, because we are made in the image of God. So we're going to take a look at a few samples now, okay. All right, of animals and humans side by side. So this first example is a primate sample, four different samples of primate for our next two samples of human hair. Remember we said human hair, their medulla pattern is thinner, and we can see that in, you know, evidenced here. Remember the medulla is this pattern that we have running up the center of the hair shaft here. Now, if you take a look, you're going to see the distinct difference between human and animals, all right? If we look at the medulla pattern of this primate right here, this pattern running up the center looks distinctly different from human hair, all right? Primate fur is distinctly different from human hair. There are no similarities at all in their medulla patterns. Very important.
Everything they have to prove that evolution is true breaks down when put under the microscope and when put to the test. Taxonomic classifications don't actually prove anything, but kids don't know this. This is where the beginning of deceit takes place and indoctrination begins. What most people don't know is that taxonomists also have a problem of their own. It is called taxonomic boundary paradox. The concept for a taxon today is that it can overlap in the past according to evolution theory that they now believe in. This is why taxonomists are constantly moving and placing things in these different tree branches. But originally, this was not a problem for taxonomy, as it was invented by a Christian creationist who stated that animal families were fixed. Just like Darwin divided up humans into different races, evolutionists have now come along and called man an ape. They call us by a higher taxonomic rank because they know it is a way to sway a child's mind. Carl Linnaeus, the father of taxonomy, believed that he was God's chosen instrument for revealing, in a precise way, the divinely ordered work of creation. As a creationist, he initially shared the then prevalent view that each species had originally been specially created by God. In his book, he wrote, "There are as many species as the infinite being produced diverse forms in the beginning." Here's a cool fact. Linnaeus did not believe in evolution, just variation within major groups, which is what creationists accept today. In his lifetime, he was called the second Adam, because the first Adam named all the animals, and Linnaeus came along and renamed them in Latin. He classified mankind, humans, as Homo sapiens, and placed us in the genus Homo in 1758 as the only member of that species, a totally separate kind, because the Latin noun Homo means human being. However, he had to place humans somewhere. So he placed them into the class quadrupeds, along with apes and sloth. And in 1740, Linnaeus added anteaters to this group. What made Linnaeus link humans to nature was only one thing, and that was the female trait of living birth and the suckling of the young. While what separates humans from their co-inhabitants of the class of primate and the order of mammals was the soul and the mind, indicated in the motto for humans and the specific name he gave them, Homo sapiens, which means to know thyself, in his third edition. But we know today what the truth is. Gene sequencing has shown that humans are nearly all identical to one another, no matter how far back you go in time. It doesn't matter if you're looking at Neanderthal or Denisovan or where in the world you go to test people alive today. We are all related, contrary to what evolution predicted and taught to the public. If people ever ask what makes humans different from apes, make sure to give them the list that I provide for you with this video. So the next time some idiot says, "We are just apes," tell them, "Prove it." I dare you. Go have sex with an ape and record it and give it to the police. And when you get arrested for bestiality, which is sex with an animal, stand in front of the judge and use that "we're just apes" argument and see how well that goes for you. I dare you. So in closing, taxonomy was first invented by a Christian creationist. So we own the hierarchies that evolution tries to use against us today. When taxonomy was adapted by evolutionists, it became an immediate paradox called the taxonomic boundary paradox, because things that were once set with boundaries now overlap going back into the past. thus classification breaks down going back in time. So they have to climb down the evolutionary tree of classification in an attempt to show relation, hoping that nobody notices taxonomy has been abused. Until we eventually get retarded arguments like, "Are you a eukaryote?" implying that if we are eukaryotes, then we must also be everything in between the first eukaryotic organism and humans today. Stupidity really knows no bounds when dealing with someone who hates an alternative model that refutes their own. Taxonomy is subjective, and it can change at any moment, at any time, for any reason, as seen fit by the taxonomist. And a final reminder, taxonomy proves nothing. They use it as proof, but it is not proof. It is a play on words used today as proof by those who have no good evidence. Because of all the problems, evolution believers have recently had to invent their own taxonomic system to replace the old one that has been a thorn in their side from the start, because it contradicts them and their made-up phylogenetic tree of lies that they created.
And so that's why our evolutionists struggle with that, because, well, this doesn't really reflect at least their reality.
If it doesn't work, if it needs improvements, then we have to fix it.
Remember, they invented phylogenetic trees to unite all life, and all of them know the problems that they have with it today. And with this new system, they can easily swindle kids and the public even more with word games to those that don't know any better. For those of us that do know and understand how it works and notice it, they are forced to admit the flaws, and thus had to invent their own systems because they could not proclaim their bullshit evolutionary common ancestry without a paradox. So now, with their own made-up system based on their own fable, they can now easily deceive people linguistically and move species around in their ever-changing phylogenetic tree of lies. Sadly, the kids stand no chance. You see, genetic similarity only goes so far. For example, we share about the same amount of genetics with a banana as we do with a chicken, and about the same as a fruit fly. Does that mean that we split millions of years ago when the banana and the chicken did? Of course not. And we know this because a banana is a recent creation of humans. We hybridized and created the banana. So genetic similarity has nothing to do with divergence time, and it does not prove common ancestry. It shows common design and functional capabilities. Our genetic similarity should be expected to be similar and closer to apes because they live in a similar environment, they both give similar types of birth, they both live on land, and physiologically we work in similar ways, so of course we're going to have more relation. But remember, that 98% number that you always hear in the press is pure fiction. We are not 99% related, and the number is told to the public to make it look like we're kissing cousins. It is just more evolutionary lies sold to the public to push their narrative as though it is a fact. Their agenda is clear. Evolution is true without question. But many things can help us determine what a kind is. Orphan genes are one such phenomenon, as they are taxonomically restrictive genes that only function in species within a particular family. We also have in vitro fertilization, we have skin grafting techniques, we have mutation rates, we have a broad spectrum of things that help us show what a created kind is. But this should not be true if evolution was true. This is where their religion of deep time comes from. They just invoke time, and time magically solves the problem.